I start my conversation with this couplet that the finance minister quoted. She said, "Yakhin ho to koi rasta nikalta hai. Yakhin ho to koi rasta nikalta hai. Hawa ki od bhi lekar chirag jalta hai." When we look at this budget, let's quickly go over what was good on this budget. The first point that I underlined and I thought was heartwarming was the fact that the finance minister announced that we will have foreign students coming to India, which is a great thing. You know, no great country has an education system that only has its own students. All the great countries, one of the common features is that people from all over the world go and study there, whether it is the US, UK or China. You will find that a lot of Indian students study in China. We are the only country in that top 6-7 where you don't find any foreign students. This statement is important for a variety of reasons. One, it means that our education system will open up. Secondly, it will mean that we have to open up other things. If we have to allow foreign students to come in, we have to have a better visa policy. Right now, India doesn't give visas for students beyond 1 year. So if you are here on a 3-year course and you get a 1-year visa, it is very unlikely that you will come and join. The second point that she made, the government will launch something called a Gandhipedia. The third point, which was that there will be fresh investment in the space sector, that ISRO will be given more money, ISRO will get into commercialization. If that happens, it will be a great thing. Point number four, shopkeepers who earn less than 1.5 crores or whose turnovers are less than 1.5 crores will be given pensions. You know, this is a very vulnerable section of our society, particularly after demonetization. And you know, the kind of attrition there is very high. But there's one more little thing where the finance minister announced that there will be a national research foundation. The government is announcing some centralized research foundation. It's a great step. What disappointed us was that this huge research foundation for the whole country is going to get some pittance of 200 crore rupees. Hopefully that will go up. This is often the problem with a large number of schemes that have been announced in the recent past. Very big ticket schemes. Remember the smart cities? You know, those 100 smart cities, where did they go? One of the reasons you don't see them is because each smart city was given 100 crores. If I were to headline my comment on the budget, it will be that this budget put the stamp of centralization on governance in India. And let me explain. That's the broad theme I want to convey, that this budget, like no other budget earlier, stated very loudly that we are no longer a federal nation. That's the most pernicious part of what the finance minister of the message that the finance minister conveys, and I'll tell you why. Now, it's very interesting. There were two new ministries announced in the last 2 months. Soon after the new government took shape, when the portfolios were announced, remember, there's one new ministry. There was one new ministry carved out of the Ministry of Agriculture, and that is the Ministry of Dairying and Animal Husbandry. And the first thing that the minister announced was that he's going to give ID cards and validation to the cow vigilantes. That was the first ministry announced. Again, a very state subject, but a big central ministry now. The budget announced a new ministry, and that was the Jal Shakti ministry. Another state subject. The first 15 minutes of the budget spent entirely on the third state subject, which was a long speech on the farmers, on agriculture. So the thing was, after this whole foreword on agriculture, which gave a lot of emphasis on farm stress, came the solution to agriculture distress. The solution is zero budget natural farming. The definition of zero budget natural farming is stop using fertilizers, stop using pesticide, start using cow urine mixed with jaggery. That is the solution to all farming problems in the country. Come to the serious parts of the budget where we are looking at the numbers. This budget has a revenue income of about 19 lakh crores and it will spend about 24 lakh crores. But when we go back and look at the economic survey, then we find that that figure that the finance minister is saying, which is 19.5 lakh crores, is nowhere in the economic survey. The closest figure of revenue mobilization is 18 lakh crores. Now that means that we are talking about a shortfall of 1.5 lakh crores. It's come from the same ministry. Now what happens is that when you fudge national data, one is that you know you can fudge and report it, but how do you then spend that money? How do you then give money to the people you have promised money? And that is why you will find that especially over the last couple of years, several expenses are not committed, are not done, or worse, are not paid for. You will find that in largely in NREGA cases. What is the big issue with fiscal deficit? Why are we so concerned about fiscal deficit? And why was the finance minister so very obsessed with the fiscal deficit figure? However, because the interest payments can go up, and that is why they have a bearing on bank interest rates and on inflation, you have to keep them low. The negative consequence of keeping price low is that farm prices stay low. There is a very simple economic principle which says that if you keep prices low, you will generate larger unemployment. Inflation and employment have an inverse relationship. Why would a government, why would a political party want to increase unemployment in society? Deliberately keep inflation low, that the only reason to do that is because this country doesn't care about jobs. In fact, let me expand it and say that this election shows that we don't care about the economy. What I'm suggesting is, you keep prices low, you will win the election. You let prices go high, you will lose the next election. While the finance minister did not acknowledge it, there is a serious stress on revenue side, that we are not earning enough money by taxes. Why are we not earning enough money by taxation? Because we have hugely overestimated our GST collection. Our disinvestment proceeds, which were supposed to be 90,000 crores, we could reach only 60,000 crores. Income tax. So therefore, what does the government do? We hear the finance minister saying, I am going to tax those who earn more than 2 crore rupees at a higher rate. But then she delivers the number. So she says that now I am going to tax those who earn more than 2 crores 3% of surcharge. The final point on which some of us got completely scandalized was that to increase revenue, this time the finance minister said that we will reduce it to 25% for those firms that have a turnover less than 400 crores. Now, what is the catch there? 95% of our firms are firms which have less than 400 crore turnover. So they will all get benefited. The point is that the firms that provide employment are the firms that generate more than 400 crores. They are not going to get any benefit. They were the ones who are waiting for this 25%. Even in corporate taxation, if you are paying effectively 40% corporate tax in India, it makes far more sense for you to go and live in Singapore at 6% or Dubai at 3%. And that is the trend we have seen over the last 5 years. Which brings me to the indirect taxation. That GST is flopped in that sense. It's getting us lesser and lesser revenue. Therefore, how do you make up that loss? Import duties were increased. It hasn't happened in 25 years, at least I don't remember. Import duties went up. And import duties go up on what? The first import duty that she announces, which really, you know, got me speechless, was an import duty on books. There is an import duty on newsprint, on newspapers. I said, no, this one I must understand. Why should anybody do that? Why do you want to make newspapers expensive? The only answer I can give, and you know, you may not agree with me, that in the election campaign, the electronic media was a very faithful partner. The only media that actually spoke out was the print media. So here you are, right? you become more expensive. But the big one was the third one. The most bizarre import duty increase was the third, and that was that gold import duties now have been increased to 12.5%. You know, one of the first things that Manmohan Singh as finance minister had done was to reduce import duty on gold to 2%. With that one move, one entire sector just disappeared from the economy, and that was the gold smuggler. See, the other interesting thing, the other sad thing that has happened to the Indian economy over the last 5 years has been that for the first time since 1984, we've had a record 32 months of continuous decline in exports. And it's bizarre because the decline in exports is happening despite the rupee being at its lowest ever. The rupee has stabilized at 70 rupees. But despite the rupee falling, the export never rose. Now, what have we done? We've made gold expensive. Our third largest export item is jewelry. We were already struggling there, and now we make gold that much more expensive. What do we do for the middle class? We say that if you buy a house worth 45 lakh rupees, you will get a slightly bigger tax exemption of in your interest rates. And we say that those who are so some tinkering in the housing sector. We expected some major tinkering there because the construction sector has just stopped. There is no construction activity happening, which explains much of the unemployment that you see in the country. And this is an interesting one, that the finance minister announced that three new sectors will be opened up for foreign investment. One, the first one, single brand retail. Why would you do 100% FDI for single brand retail only? It makes sense to do it for multi-brand retail. Some of us have been arguing for a long time that multi-brand retail should open up. The basic reason being that multi-brand retail employs a large number of people, of unskilled people. And secondly, multi-brand retail has a very immediate impact on agriculture productivity because of better pricing and grading. You know, I did a lot of search to find which single brand retailer will want to come to India. There is only one firm for which this has been done, and that is Apple. Nothing else. There is nobody else who benefits on this except Apple. The second item on which FDI is opened up is media. Media. All of a sudden, suddenly from nowhere, we will have foreign media. Something we have opposed for several years, saying foreign media is bad, etc. Does it mean that Pranoy Roy is off the hook? I don't know. Because that's what you are going to, that's what you are chasing him for. And so hopefully, if that is also retrospectively allowed. And the third is aviation, which means all these Air Asia and, you know, this whole jet air mess. Is it going to get worse or better? We don't know. That this budget announces a unitary government. This budget announces that whether it is water, whether it is healthcare, whether it is education, we will decide. The new education policy came a little before the budget. It says that the center will decide education. Primary, secondary, higher education. Nirmala Sitharaman announced, we will decide on labor reforms. Again, I mean, Jaitley has said it in 2014, did nothing for the next 5 years. She has said it again. If she does it, it's again a state subject that she is taking over. The evidence comes from one announcement that she made, which was that the center will now decide on tenancy laws. You see, tenancy law is a very specific state subject. What is the center doing defining tenancies? And that is what she's. So my summary of this budget is A, that it is a budget that continues with enormous amount of exaggeration on the revenue front, and therefore will have to scurry to meet fiscal deficit targets towards the end. Then the Prime Minister made about three big promises. He said, one, that he will give interest-free short-term loans to the farmer. It was a big announcement. The second was that he will give 50 lakh of collateral fee loans to all youth. And there was a third which I am. And there was this housing for all. there was no mention of any of these in the budget. Not a single pie. There was no mention of Ayushman, which was supposed to be a flagship. In fact, Ayushman disappeared. Even during the campaign, it disappeared. And in the budget, doesn't find any mention at all. There is only a little mention of managing fisheries. Apart from this, nothing else.